a small boat on the ocean, sending big waves into motion, like how a single word can make a heart open. I might only have one match, but I can make an explosion. This is my fight song. Take back my life.
Most gracious God, today we come, indeed thanking you and offering to you a joyful hymn of praise. God, we thank you for the opportunity to gather with one heart and one spirit, to once again give you thanks that you are God and that we are not. God, we confess that when it comes to living this life, there are at times where we take the reins and control of our own life, that we fail to remember that your purposes and your plans are greater than our own. As we walk through life, we also encounter the tragedy and at times even the agony of defeat. It's easy for us to be defined by those agonies, to be defined by defeat, and yet you remind us this day that because you came, because you lived, that agony is turned into a thrill of victory. In and of myself, O Lord, I am unable to do what you call me to do, and that is to share your word with your people. I pray that the words that come forth from my mouth are words that are formed by you, that whatever is spoken, that you would take it and anoint it by the power of the Holy Spirit in such a way that it might challenge us where we need to be challenged, convict us where we need to be convicted, encourage us where we need to be encouraged. Most gracious God, we pray this day that you indeed might speak, for your servants are listening. And all of God's followers said, amen. Well, good morning. Before we get started this morning, I want to thank Hal for the gift of his leadership with us. So glad to have you. As you know, Tony, his aunt has passed away, and so he is headed to outside of Houston, Texas. And Ann Russell's father-in-law, Scott's dad, had a heart procedure on Friday. So invite you to be in prayer for continued healing in both of our pastors' lives. It was February 1980, and it was a tough time in America. Some of you may remember that 52 Americans spent the last 3 months mostly blindfolded as hostages in Iran, and would be such for almost another year. All around the world, a common sight on the evening news was that somewhere, someone was burning our American flag. Interest rates were hovering around 15%. Inflation was somewhere in the neighborhood of 13%. The Cold War was in full effect. Nuclear armament and concerns that if they pushed the button, then we would have to push the button too. It was a time freighted with concern and fear for what might be. It was also a time when the world was coming to Lake Placid, New York for the Olympic Games. And there were some areas and some events where we as Americans had optimism. Eric Heiden was a speed skater, and he showed great promise, and he delivered on that promise. He competed in 5 events at those Olympics, and he received a gold medal in each and every event he competed in. One of our American skiers did fairly well, but one area where there was absolutely no room for optimism whatsoever was our hockey team. Now, some of you may have remembered that the Soviets at this time absolutely ruled international hockey. And they did for some 40 years. By some string of events and some talent, we might even say, the Americans had made it to the semifinal round of the Olympics in the hockey. But they had been matched up and paired with the dreaded Soviets. Everyone looked upon that game, and they were already chalking it up, already once again feeling the agony of defeat. And I mean, why shouldn't they? Because just 13 days prior, the Russians and the Americans had an exhibition match at Madison Square Garden where the Soviets just destroyed the Americans with a score of 13-2. The first period, the Soviets dominated. And nobody was surprised except by the fact that at the end of the first period, the score was only 2-1. And that one goal by the Americans was scored as time was running out. Well, the Soviet coach was so infuriated that he took his all-star goalie and he benched him as if to be a symbol and as a sign to the whole world that they were such a superior team that even they could beat these inferior Americans with their backup goalie. And sure enough, the second period proved to find support in that thinking. For again, the Soviets dominated. They had 12 shots on goal, whereas Americans, we had 2. But surprisingly enough, as the second period came to a close, the Soviets were only leading 3-2. And then inexplicably, the Soviets, who were so used to scoring in bunches, were actually being shut out by the Americans. And sure enough, these were a bunch of ragtag college kids that had no business even being in this semifinal match. And sure enough, with 8 minutes and 39 seconds left in the game, Johnson scored his second goal of the night, tying it from 3-3. And then astoundingly, just 81 seconds later, Mike Arizoni does this. Take a look.
And now, to me, the game takes on a whole new outlook.
The Americans, losers 10-3, 13 days ago. The game now tied.
It's 3-3. Now it's a hockey game.
A hockey game that wouldn't stay tied for long. Because just 81 seconds later, the team captain, whose name in Italian means eruption, triggered one.
Puck bounces out to me coming over the blue line. You know, as my friends say to me to this day, if, you know, 3 more inches to the left, you'd be painting bridges.
The U.S. team is depending a little bit too much now on Jim Craig. He's making too many good saves.
And that's when the building went crazy. I mean, that's when sound had feel. I mean, that was like an earthquake.
You want to talk about the thrill of victory. Do some of you remember this? The thrill of victory were these college students who had no business being here, defeated all of the odds, even when they faced tragedy after tragedy. For over 20 years, they experienced the thrill of victory. And the thrill of victory against the Soviets propelled them to the final round, where they beat Finland and received the gold medal, a feat in American hockey that we haven't seen since. You see, this was known as the Miracle on Ice. It's a victory that once again united us as a nation and filled us with a hope of expectation and a sense of joy. And what we learn from this story is that the thrill of victory oftentimes come out of a repeated agony of defeat. In the U.S. hockey team's case, 2 decades, 20 years of experiencing continued agony of defeat again and again. And when you think about it, every elite hockey player for these 20 years got their skates. They would strap them on with hope, with expectations. They would put in everything they had, all of their sweat, all of their blood, practicing 10 to 14 hours a day, lifting, running, skating, giving it all. only year after year to come up short. You see, it would have been so easy for those skaters simply to walk away and to say, our failures are final. How easy that would have been. And how easy that is in our own lives as well. For we too can conclude and be tempted to believe that our failure is the final word. That the final word is how we see ourselves. That our failure has the final word in how others see us. And that our failure even has the final word in how God sees us. You see, where have you invested your blood, your sweat, and your tears? And where have you come up short? Where have you felt the agony of defeat? For some of you, you've invested your blood, sweat, and tears in the work that you do day in and day out. You've heard the rumors. You've heard the scuttlebutt that indeed, perhaps they're going to need to make cuts. And you fear that when they do make cuts, that you're the next one to go. There may be some of you that even though he or she still lives in the house, it's clear that they've walked out and left a long time ago, leaving you to deal with the kids and to figure out all of the collateral damage that comes with it. For others of you, it may be a loved one who is in denial, who over self-medicates day in and day out, and you can't do anything about it, and the only thing you're aware of is the growing sense of frustration and rage and anger that's finding its way into your own soul. Or maybe it happens to be just a routine checkup that you find out is anything but routine. You see, all of us, not just Olympic athletes, know the agony of defeat. And as we gather this morning, we remember that this includes Jesus himself. As important it is for us to remember, God in the flesh was not unaccustomed or unacquainted with the agony of defeat. Even before Jesus came, we hear the prophet Isaiah say these words, "For he was despised and rejected by others, a man of suffering and familiar with pain, like one from whom people hide their faces, he was despised. And we held him in low esteem. For surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him. And by his wounds, we are healed." You see, Jesus knows the crushing weight of rejection and disregard. He also knows the hearts of fickle followers like you and me. Because as long as something was in it for others, for them, then the crowds and the masses around Jesus were great. As long as there is a miracle that they could see, perhaps a healing that could occur, as long as they could even hang out and maybe get a nice fish dinner, then the crowds were great. But as soon as Jesus started talking about things like loving your enemies, denying yourself, taking up your cross and following him, as soon as he started talking radical things, so much so like money and personal security, even family could not come between us and God's call to follow him. As long as there was something in it for others, people were on board. But soon as they realized that Jesus was to ask something and even require something of them, well, then those crowds diminished. So much so that Jesus was left with just the 12. And if truth be known, even they were wondering and wouldn't stay around into the deepest and darkest experience in which Jesus himself knows the agony of defeat. The 24 hours where he gives of absolutely everything in his life. You see, the most elite athletes in the world have theirs. We now know that the author and pioneer and perfecter of our faith even has his. So where is yours? Where is your agony of defeat? And perhaps even the greater question is, what do we do with them? What do we do with defeats and failures when they do come about in our life? And I want to suggest that we have a couple of options. One option is simply for us to say that our failures are final, that indeed our future is even futile, so why go ahead? I mean, like those when it came to the U.S. hockey team, 20 years. 20 years they could have simply said, you know what, why try again? We've tried since 1976. All of our best hockey players have given of themselves and it can't happen. You know what, let's hang up our cleats. Let's hang them up. Hang up our skates. And by so doing, our failures are final. And our future is futile. And if they had done that, and if we are tempted to do that as well, what happens is that we become defined. We become defined by the emotions and the agony of defeat that comes with it. We too can be defined by thinking that our failures are final, that our future and our efforts indeed moving forward are futile, and that there's no point. And that can be such a tempting thing for us to face in the midst of the agony of defeat. Or we can choose to persist. Why? Well, it's not because it's the easy way. I mean, just look to Jesus as he went through the ridicule and the rejection and the betrayal and the beatings. It wasn't the easy way for Jesus. And we know that, according to Scripture, that Jesus was tempted in every way just as we are. So we know that as Jesus is looking to experience his own agony of defeat, he too was tempted to say, the failures are too great. The failures can be final. The future, is this even indeed worth it? Is the future futile? Is what I'm going through, suffering and giving all that I have, going to make any difference? And yet what we realize is that we don't persevere through our failures because it's the easy way, because it's simple, because it's pain-free. But what we do is we go through our failures and pains, facing the agony of defeat with perseverance, because it is the only pathway in which we turn our defeat into victory. We each are called to persevere in the power and in the presence of Christ, believing and trusting that whatever agony we face, that on the other side is a thrill of victory that has been claimed and named with the blood of Jesus. And I don't want you to simply take my words for it. In fact, why don't you hear about the pain of the agony of defeat and the thrill of victory from an Olympic athlete, from Candy Merrill. Take a listen to her story.
The thrill of victory and the agony of defeat. I am far more afraid of the agony of defeat than I am excited about the thrill of victory. And if you are working on something that involves everything culminating in a moment in time, you run the risk of the agony of defeat. I was actually in the middle of my college career and I was just having a lot of fun with some of the other U of A athletes eating Tostino's pizza rolls and found myself a little bit overweight, a little undertrained, and went to the 1982 World Championships and lost. Losing that World Championship has been a blessing in disguise. And I have, as many other people have, had many other World Championship losses in my life. But you do get through it. And one of my favorite sayings is the best way out is through. There's always a light.
The best way out is through. Now, the agony of defeat that Candy Merrill experienced in 1982 would compel her to actually win the gold medal at the Olympics, the Summer Olympics in 1984. We realize that as we look to the games, we've been very intentional about last week talking about endurance and perseverance and today talking about the agony of defeat and the thrill of victory, because the two of them are inexorably linked. God bless you. And we discover also in the midst of this that this is the message of the gospel. There's perhaps no better scripture that captures this than in 1 Corinthians when we hear, "Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? And where, O death, is your sting? For the sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, for he gives the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know your labor in the Lord is not in vain." We know that death has been swallowed up. That is our Easter victory. Jesus himself shows us that our failures are not final, that when it comes to facing indeed our future and moving forward, that it is not futile, that God is present in the midst of us, in the defeat and in the agony and in the thrill of victory. A paraphrase says it this way: "Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, persevere. Let nothing stop you. Always give yourselves fully to the mission of God in the world, which is bringing life and love to everyone, including you. And know that your perseverance in God's mission in you and in the world is not in vain." You see, for almost 5 days in the fall, he lay in the fetal position in his Baltimore home, crestfallen, depressed, and wondering if he even wanted to live. In his own words, he says, "I was a train wreck. I was a time bomb simply waiting to go off. I had no self-worth. I had no self-esteem." He admits that ultimately he was lost. From the world's standards, he had achieved everything. He had accomplished every feat imaginable, to the point that men wanted to be him and little boys pretended that they were him. It was the greatest, most decorated Olympic medalist of all times, Michael Phelps, faced a tragedy of defeat within himself that even the water could not relinquish. You see, at the age of 9, Michael's father had walked out on he and his mom and his 2 older sisters, leaving them alone. And for years, Michael admits that he buried those emotions. Deep down, he felt abandoned by his father. He felt the weight of the world upon his shoulders, and he felt at any moment that he wanted to get out of it at whatever it cost. So we know that at the age of 19, he received his first DUI. Shortly after the London Olympics, he was found showing a picture using an illegal substance. And then again, in 2014, he was arrested for his second DUI. He had a problem. And not only did he have a problem, but now this problem overreached into his swimming career. Because after his second DUI, the USA Swimming Association banned him from the sport for 6 months, and they said he could not compete in the world championships in Russia. Those that were closest to him were afraid. They saw the tremendous agony, the tremendous defeat. They saw even him debating whether he wanted to live. And yet, a famous friend and fellow Baltimore sensation and Raven football player, Ray Lewis, came to his need to meet him at one of his darkest moments. And this is what he said. Take a look.
"Advice from longtime friend, mentor, and fellow Baltimore icon Ray Lewis lifted Phelps.
I'm like, baby boy, listen to me. This is when we fight. This is when real character shows up. Don't shut down, because if you shut down, we all lose. And so to hear a younger brother say some of the things he was saying, right, about, and I'm like, really? Really? Okay, let me give you an example of what you say messing up is. And so for me, I had to go back into some of my dark days and things that wasn't pretty on my side. And so what we started to reinstall in him was, let me show you who you are. I want to expose to you really who you are.
Let me show you who you are. His words are, this is when we fight. And Michael Phelps did fight. He then went to 45 days of rehab where he looked at his chemical dependency, where he began to peel back the layers of the pain and the hurt and the feelings of abandonment from his father. He hadn't had relationship with his father for years. And before he went to rehab, Ray Lewis gave him a familiar book, one that many of you have read. He gave him Rick Warren's The Purpose-Driven Life. For the first time ever in Michael Phelps' life, he began reading. He began hearing about the message and the power of Jesus Christ and Christ's claim upon his life. The most decorated Olympian of all time, for the first time ever, confessed to Lewis that God has a purpose and God has a plan for my life. There was a parents' weekend while he was in recovery, and he sent his dad an invitation, not thinking that he would come, only to realize that his dad showed up. And when his dad showed up for the first time in all of those many years, he was able to share with him how he felt abandoned. He was able to share with him the hurt that he experienced from his father leaving. He shared with them how when he was a young boy, how he needed a father's influence and he wasn't there to be found. And then he said, I'm tired of living a life in which I am bound with so much hatred and anger, and I want to be free and forgive you as we move forward. You see, in the midst of Michael Phelps' agony of defeat, the reason he was able to extend forgiveness to his earthly father is because for the first time ever in his life, he had experienced the forgiveness of a heavenly father. A heavenly father that wants you and me to know that when it comes to your failures, they're not final. When it comes to your future, move forward boldly and unafraid because it is not futile. That there is a purpose and a plan in your life, and God's not done with you yet. And so I ask you, where is your agony of defeat? Where are your failures claiming the identity of who you are? And where is God inviting you into a future to be completely unafraid? As you consider those here once again, the power of God's ultimate victory, that death has been swallowed up. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? For the sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, but he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor in the Lord is never in vain. May it be so in your life, and may it be so in mine. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.